All right.
Hello. So today we will do more things on orthonormal matrices. We'll get to the application called transform coding. You might have noticed there is a next project posted on that topic. Who looked at it already? One, two, three, two and a half. Okay, not many of you. Just I guess good because I am. I will talk about this topic a little bit more today, which is essentially an application of very cool application of orthonormal matrices. Okay, well, let's just go in there. So this is what I discussed the last time. So orthonormal matrix can be rectangular, right? And we call it orthonormal if the columns form an orthonormal set of vectors or orthonormal bases. You already know that what we said the last time on Monday was that orthonormal implies linearly independent, right? And certainly it spans some sort of subspace, so of course it must be a basis. So that's nothing special. Yeah, and I think I also mentioned that you can write it neatly as the QTQ equals identity. That's equivalent. This equality is equivalent to requiring that the column vectors are orthonormal. So this is what we discussed the last time, and just quickly recapping that. Oh, yeah, I think what I ended with was this, right? Just showing that. Oh, you know what? Let's close the door. I think this is what we finished with last time. That says that if I take a vector and apply an orthonormal matrix to it, it doesn't even have to be square. All that matters is that's orthonormal columns, then the length of the vector doesn't change after the application. So if I take y and I get a new vector x by transforming using q, then the norm of x will be the same as norm of y. Like you can, of course, square root it at the end if you want. And I said that the same thing is true also for the dot product. And that basically gives you the idea that orthonormal matrices, at least square orthonormal matrices, where you can talk about inversion, that they are essentially like the n-dimensional generalization of rotations. There's one little catch that there can also be reflections, and we will learn how to distinguish the two when we talk about determinant. I think I already said that rotations have to have determinant one, right? But orthonormal matrices with determinant one, they are basically the generalization of rotations to n dimensions. It's sort of tricky to think about rotation in n dimensions. It's easy to imagine rotation in 2D and 3D, right? But what is rotation in 4D? There it starts getting already interesting. In 4D, it even has some special properties. I looked at this at some point. You can some sort of decompose it, rotations about two planes and so on, and 5D and so on. But the point is that orthonormal matrices, they don't really care about the dimension. They work beautifully in any dimension. And actually today, the transform coding will be applying the orthonormal matrices in like crazy dimensions, right? So let's get there. So this is the application and also your project, I guess project number four, project for this week. And the idea is, what is it about? It's basically a lossy signal compression. Okay, and by signal, we will look at two types of, focused, right? It's better? Okay. So we'll look at two types of signals, 1D signal and 2D signal. 1D signal is audio, right? Like a sound wave. And 2D signal, that's an image. So if you have a sound, like I'm recording the sound right now, right? So what the thing is recording, there is some continuous signal going on, right? Being recorded by the microphone. If you can look at it, that's what you can do like in MATLAB. And I sort of explained that you can load some wave files and just like graph this and you can see it. If there's nothing going on, it will be flat. Like the louder it is, the higher amplitude you will see and so on. But generally, this doesn't make that much of a sense. And the signal, you can imagine it's continuous signal in the real world. That's the model we are normally assuming. But when you want to process it on the computer, you of course cannot have a continuous signal. You need to sample it, right? So you have something, some sampling rate, which essentially means these ticks. it too tiny? Is it visible? The ticks on the, so this axis is time, right? And you have regularly spaced samples in time.
But they are pretty, they are usually fairly close, right? But what is the typical sampling rate for audio? I actually forgot. Do you remember that? Is it like 44 kilohertz? Yeah. So that means like 44,000 samples per second, right? So these samples, they are like incredibly dense, right? There's really a lot of them. And the idea is that you really capture the signal accurately so that when you play it back, the human doesn't tell the difference between, cannot even tell that it was sampled, right? I guess even a more obvious example would be animation, right? If you have a movie, if you're looking at a movie, it's actually not like continuous smooth motion, they are discrete frames, right? Like how animators used to do it back in the day before computers, where they just like draw one picture, then draw another one, but if you flip them quickly enough, then you don't really tell the difference. So with audio sampling, it's a sampling, in general sampling one-dimensional signal, it's exactly the same idea. So instead of having a continuous function, I have just these samples at discrete time intervals. Okay?
It's a tiny image, but I think it's so simple that I don't really have to do a more beautiful image. Is that clear to everybody? Great. So, and that's what your WAV file would be. That's what your sound recorded on a computer, like I'm recording right now. That's what it is, right? It's just a sequence of samples. And a sequence of samples, well, in our language, we can call it a vector, right? In the language of linear algebra. And if we are talking about a vector, then you can sort of imagine that by default, our vector is expressed with respect to a standard basis, okay? So if I like record like a couple seconds of audio, then you will get maybe a couple hundred thousand dimensional vector, right? So, but that's totally cool. It's like you will have R to 100,000 dimensions or R to 1,000,000. You still have there the standard basis, right? And by default, you can imagine the vector is represented with respect to the standard basis, right? You know, by standard basis, I mean these guys, one and all zeros, then. And so on. Okay. Well, one thing you notice immediately, one thing I notice every time I sort of think when I will finally run out of space for the videos which I'm recording in the laptop, it takes a lot of space, right? Maybe a couple seconds, no big deal, but if you are recording in like an actual lecture worth of video and audio, that takes a lot of space, obviously. Certainly, if you need 44,000 samples per second, it's a lot of samples. It quickly adds up, right? And it's even more for video, because that's basically like a three-dimensional signal, right? It has two spatial dimensions, and the third would be the time. So that grows even faster. So the idea of transform coding, the thing I'll be explaining now, is how to use the theory of orthogonal matrices to create a really cool lossy compression scheme. It's hard if you think about it intuitively, like if I have some input signal, I mean, there is like lots of theory about it. You can study this like signal processing and so on. I'll just give you sort of like the 30,000 foot overview of that. But let's just think about it. There is some continuous signal, which might be complicated, but it's not completely crazy. It's not completely random, right? Unless you are dealing with some noise or some special type of signal, but something like speech, right? That has some structure to it. So it's not like completely random signal. It has some structure to it. Just think about it like this. So if I keep increasing the sampling rate, like if I have like my original sampling rate is like this, and if I increase it by 2, all of a sudden, I have twice as much data, right? And if I increase it even by 2, again, I have twice as much data, right? But the actual quality doesn't really improve that much from a certain point, right? Because at some point, basically, the new samples are not really giving me that much more information, right? So what's normally happening is that you are sampling your signal conservatively high. You better want to oversample it rather than undersample it. By the way, do you know how it's called? What happens if you undersample it? If there is not enough samples? That's actually such a common thing, it even has a name. Have you seen sometimes there is like this, like, I guess, famous artifact. If you have like a car going really quickly in a movie, and it goes so, and the wheels are spinning, and they're, aliasing, exactly. That's the artifact related to undersampling your signal, exactly. So let me finish that as I also started. As you have, like, if you film a car, like a race car that goes really fast, and the wheels are spinning, because the camera only has a discrete sampling frequency, it can happen that it will look like that the wheels are spinning the other way around. That's exactly aliasing problem. So you don't want aliasing. So it creates artifacts. So you prefer to oversample it rather than undersample it, because by oversampling you will only generate more data, right? But you will not really introduce some bad artifacts. Nevertheless, there will be a lot of data, and we need to deal with them somehow. And this basically tells us how we can deal with them. Okay. So how do we connect it back to the orthonormal matrices we talked about? So in this case, we will need only square orthonormal matrices. So everything is beautiful. We can talk about inverses and so on. And in this case, we can think of the orthonormal matrix as a change of coordinates. Just like we talked before when we are talking about the robots and so on, about change of coordinates in 2D and 3D, orthonormal matrices in n by n, but it could be a million or 10 million, whatever, you can also view it as a change of coordinates. Maybe let me try to explain it. Let's see if it will make sense already. Let me try to explain it a little bit. So let's say that V is my vector, which corresponds to some signal from Rn. And Rn, the n can be huge here. Like, imagine it's like a wave file. You load it in MATLAB, so it's like 100,000 samples. And if you play it back, you get some sound, like beep or something. OK, so you can say that basically, like, one way you can view it, that like this is like a dumb thing. So I can put there n by n identity, right? As basically says that the individual components of V, so if I split the V into the individual components, V1 to Vn, and the I's identity, I is the matrix of standard basis vectors, right? So what you can basically, how you can interpret it is that this is a linear combination of the standard basis vectors and the elements of V, okay? Now you might be thinking that I'm just dumb. What am I trying to do? Here is what I'm trying to do. Identity can be written as QTQ, right? The Q is my absolutely arbitrary orthonormal matrix, right? All I need here is QTQ is identity, right? Since QTQ is identity, I can just say that V is, well, identity V, let me copy that, and that is QTQ V, right? Brackets like this. Well, but I have associativity of matrix multiplication, right? So I can write it like this. And now let's think about this for a second. So what does this mean? So QV is going to be some vector. So Q is an n by n matrix, right? And QV is going to be some vector, right? That's going to be some n by 1 vector. So let's say that its elements are, for example, c1, c2, and cn. It's just a notation thing, okay? It's an n by 1 vector. Now, what is qt? Qt is, of course, also an n by n matrix, right? And let's look what is in it. So let's say that my qt, it's a square matrix. And QT looks like this. So I will denote the columns of it as Q1 up to Qn. Okay. So this is QT. This is my vector QV. So what is happening here? I'm taking a linear combination of the columns of Q with these coefficients. Do you see the analog with this? Here I was taking linear combination of the standard basis vectors. Those are the columns of identity, are the standard basis vectors, right? Here I'm taking linear combination of the columns of QT. So those are some orthonormal vectors, and these are the coefficients. Okay. So basically, what this tells me is that the QB are just coefficients of the vector with respect to a different orthonormal basis. Okay, the identity is just one, the probably the simplest orthonormal basis you can think of, but there are other orthonormal bases. There is a lot of them, right? And the whole point of transform coding is that if you pick the Q in a smart way, you will be amazed what happens to these coefficients here. Because if your V is some sort of audio wave, it would look something like this, right? But after you do the discrete cosine transformation, which is just a special form of an orthonormal matrix, that's what we are going to talk about next, then what happens to your signal is something amazing. It will do something like this. And this will be like almost zero. And that's really begging for compression, right? Because what you can do now is say, okay, let's truncate. This I discard, and I keep just the top ones. So that's essentially the main idea. So does it make sense? Any questions there?
Why does it get like shorter?
What gets shorter? This?
Yeah, I'm just confused. Like the beginning part, the physical element.
Beginning part of what, this one?
Of the bottom one.
This one?
That's
an excellent question. I haven't explained that yet. I'm going to explain it in a second. And that has to do with the structure of the Q matrix. Of course, for arbitrary Q matrix, it wouldn't do that, right? This is for cleverly chosen Q matrix. This is for the Q matrix corresponding to DC, DCT, or some other clever transformation. Okay, so not just any orthonormal matrix would do this, but this is what we are trying to get to, I guess. let me put it this way. Okay. So my point here was that the orthonormal matrix you can see as a change of coordinates. That was okay. Maybe forget about this for a second. It will make more sense on the next slide. But remember this, that the orthonormal matrix essentially is nothing but a change of coordinates. So this is basically a different orthonormal basis for the Rn space. And I can express my vector with respect to any orthonormal basis, right? This is how it's done. Super, super simple. I don't even need to do any complicated mathematics, right? No inversions, it's just transpositions. So that's what's beautiful about orthonormal matrices, okay? Okay, so it's summarized here, so let's take a look at it. So that's what I was saying. The orthonormal matrix can be interpreted as a change of coordinates, basically a rotation. It could also be a reflection. That doesn't bother us now. And this is the point I was trying to get to. If we choose the orthonormal matrix Q wisely, then the transform coordinates will be, I mean, maybe I should say localized rather than sparse. What I mean here is you will probably not get like perfectly zeros, but you will get something very small, like something here, like these things will be like much higher, or maybe orders of magnitude bigger than the things over here. And I will explain you why in a minute. And this is really the main idea of lossy compression. That's the basis of the most popular compression schemes, like in JPEG or MP3, all these things you are compressing your signals with. This is at least one of the main ideas that's being used there. Of course, it's going to be a lossy compression, but there's lossy and lossless compression, right? When lossless would be you are just reducing the information without actually making any error. In this case, we will be making some error. But the point is that for like real world signals like audio or video, that's actually okay. Or you can argue, for example, that whatever I'm recording, that has some noise too, right? And the recording device is not perfect. So if you introduce a little bit more noise in your compression step, that's actually not that big of a deal. And if you can save a lot of data by doing that, that's clearly a win. I mean, if you have a digital camera, you probably don't want to be using the RAW format unless you have really large memory card, because that will very quickly run out of memory. Okay, so let's look at the magical transformation that does the localization of your frequency domain. So that's the discrete cosine transformation. that's what you will be playing with in your next project. And the basis is quite interesting. Basically, the basis is just a sequence of sine type curves with different frequencies. So this is the formula. The formula is sort of, I mean, it's a formula. It tells you exactly what it is, but it doesn't really tell you the graphical picture, the intuition. So here the k goes from 1 to some n when n is my dimension. So the idea here is that the q1 up to qn, those would be my orthonormal basis vector. So those are Rn vectors. And this I indexes the individual components of the vectors. Okay, so the qki means vector number k and coordinate I, component I of that. Maybe let's take a look how do they look like. So let's take a look at q1. So if I go from 1 to n with my I, how do you think that the Q1 looks like? By Q1, I mean this Q1. So let's see. So K is 1, right? So how does that look like? Just substitute there. The I varies here. This is my index I going from 1 to n. Hmm? Yes, it's just a line, and it's even like a flat line. It's just a constant, basically. And by the way, this sk here is there. That's just a constant that multiplies it. That tells me how high it is. And this is just to get an orthonormal basis, ultimately. Because the point will be that I will put, these will be n-dimensional vectors, right? And I just stack them in a matrix, and I get an orthonormal matrix. And that's going to be my DCT basis, which I use for compression. Okay, so this was Q1. Now what about Q2? Q2 is a little bit trickier, right? Because here the k will be, this term will be 1, and this term goes from 1 to n minus 1. So what this ends up being is just one wave, or half wave, whatever you want to call it, of the cosine curve. So it looks like something like this. So this is my Q2. Okay. Now Q3, from 1 to n, what do you think Q3 looks like? Yes, I think you got the right idea. So I need to split it into three pieces to draw it correctly, and then it does this. That's a Q3. Are you starting to see the emerging pattern? This is like one wave of the cosine. Those would be two waves, right? So what do you think is gonna be Q4? So if this was 0, this was 1, this was 2, then I will have 3, right? So it will. So let's see if I can get this right. So I have to start here, then I go low, then I go up. Then I go low and I start and I end on the other side. So this is Q4. So you can notice that those are cosine functions of increasing frequencies. Okay. Oh, what do you think would be the Qn? That's quite interesting. The last one. I said that I go from Q1 to Qn, right? The last one is like the craziest frequency you can possibly imagine on this resolution, right? But yeah, this is a discrete resolution, right? It can be a lot, right? It can be 100,000, but it's still finite. what do you think Qn will do? Exactly. So it looks totally crazy, right? Like it looks something like I can't even draw it properly. It just goes up and down, like crazy. So the idea is really, it's just increasing the frequency and packing more and more and more and more cosine waves into this interval until the point that you can't really pack there anymore. And that's it. Now, amazingly, if you all these vectors are orthogonal. you can sort of see it trivially for these two, for example, right? Because this one would be just a constant, and this thing, if you sum all of them together, it just cancels and gives you zero. To prove that in general for any two, it's a little trickier. You need to use some trigonometric formulas. I'm not gonna go into it. There is another proof I've seen recently, which uses eigenvectors and so on, but we will need some more linear algebra for that, so we can get back to that. For now, you can just trust me that they are orthogonal. That's actually a pretty cool thing. Yeah, or if you are in MATLAB, you don't have to trust me, you can just try it, right? That's the beauty of MATLAB. You don't really have to do any math. You can just try it, compute the dot products. So what you can try, you can take all these vectors Q, put them into rows of a matrix, capital Q, right? So what are you going to do for your project will be this Qn, right? That's n dimensional vectors, so it's begging to put it into a square matrix n by n, right? In the first row is gonna be this guy, in the second row there will be this guy, and so on. And then if you do QTQ or equivalently QQT, you must get the identity. If you didn't get the S's right, what will you get instead of identity? What the S's there are for? That's just a scale, right, on each of them. I didn't put there what is here because I don't remember it, but it's easy enough to compute it. I told you before that there is this subtle difference between orthogonal and orthonormal bases, right? What was the subtle difference? Yeah?
The
right. Correct. Orthogonal means the same as orthonormal means the same as orthogonal plus that the vectors must be length 1. So that's why I have these scaling coefficients here. They make sure that all these vectors will have length 1, because I can always do this by just multiplying by a scalar, right? That's the easy part. So if you got it wrong, these scalars, instead of an identity matrix, you will get the diagonal matrix with some other numbers than ones on the diagonal. Okay, so I guess now I can explain you why for real world signals like audio recording, like sound waves, like speech, for example, why should you expect something like this? Let's think about it. So we have some signal which is like speech, and the speech does not have crazy frequencies, right? Does somebody remember like what are the like the typical frequency of speech? Like depends if you are like male or female or opera singer, can have like higher frequencies and so on, right? But there is some range, which I forgot, but it's pretty mellow. I think it's, does somebody remember that? Something like 4 to 10 or something, like maybe not even that. So if you are doing the standard sampling rate 44,000 samples per second, then you are essentially oversampling the signal a lot, right? So what that means is that if you look at your samples, if you like really zoom in, that the values will probably not be changing a whole lot from one sample to another, right? That's sort of telling you that you have like a generous sampling rate, that you are really being conservative about avoiding aliasing, right? Well, and then what happens when you do the DCT of your signal? So when you do the DCT, that's Q. So let's assume this Q, these cosine curves of different frequencies, let's put this into my matrix Q. That's the same matrix Q. Let's use this one, okay? So what happens? What does the QV do? The QV, okay, let me put it here again. Q1, right, up to Qn, let me make it even more into it. So this one was this one was this guy, this one was this, right? Here we had one more, and so on, right? And we are dot producting each of these rows with my input signal. Or it might be better, maybe more intuitive to think about it this way, that I have the waves here in the columns of QT, and the coefficients I computed by doing QB. The coefficients basically tell me how big of a contribution of each of these curves is in my signal. That's the key thing. Do you see that? Let me try to repeat it again. So if I compute QV, I get the coefficients, okay? And if I do QTQV, that basically reconstructs the signal, right? And what the reconstruction means, Q1 here is, the Q1 to Qn, those are my cosine curves of different frequencies. And the QT, I guess I could call this C, right? And the QTC, okay, let me write it like really explicitly, and that's Q1 C1 plus Qn Cn. I think I missed the cases, but that doesn't matter. So what the C's tell me, the amount of contribution of each of these cosine waves. Okay, the higher the C, the more of that cosine wave is there in my signal. So the way you can look at it, that basically what the DCT gives you, what the orthogonal transformation, orthonormal transformation tells you, it tells you how much of these individual curves is in your signal. It expresses your signal as a linear combination of these guys, all of them, right? There is like a long list until I get to this guy. And it's exactly the same as your original signal. So that's quite cool, right? Because it essentially decomposes your signal into a bunch of cosine waves and their scaling coefficients, right? So if your input signal was perfectly flat, what would you get? If your input signal was this, just a constant. Yeah?
C1 would be 1 and everything else
would be. Exactly. And the more, in general, your signal will not be constant, right? But I guess if your signal was something that does not really vary too much, what would you expect in the C? The C is sometimes called spectrum. What would you expect for some low frequency signals?
Well, you get some values at the bottom.
Hmm?
You get like a lot of zeros.
You get a lot of zeros at the end of the coefficients, exactly. And that's exactly what happens for pretty much all real world for pretty much all useful signals. There are some exceptions like high frequency noise that would like excite these crazy high frequency modes a lot. But for typical signals you want to be dealing with, like images you take with your digital camera or voice you record, this is exactly the case, that the energy or the high magnitude coefficients, they will be at the very beginning. And the further you go into these high frequencies, the smaller the coefficients are going to be in their absolute value, right? They can be negative, but that doesn't matter. What matters is sort of like the energy, the absolute value of the coefficient. And the ones near the end for typical signals, they will be close to zero. In real world signals, these high frequencies, they are quite often noise, actually. Not always. Like in images, for example, high frequencies can correspond to edges, so sometimes they are useful. But quite often they are just noise, so actually you would usually want to filter it away anyway. If you're like recording audio, you wanna filter out the noise. Okay, so that's basically the idea. And then the lossy compression is like really really simple. You basically say that instead of using the C vector, these small ones I just discard, just replace them by zeros. There you go. You get amazing compression, right? It's lossy because it was not exactly zero. It was just close to zero. But it's amazing compression. And if you do the reconstruction, you'll be amazed how well it works. So that's the DCT on 1D signals here. Any questions to that? I think it's very, very beautiful, actually, very cool. By the way, this is also related, if you heard about Fourier transformation, that's exactly the same idea. The DCT is easier to explain because it stays in the real numbers. The Fourier transformation goes to complex numbers, it gets a little more hairy, but the idea is exactly the same. Okay, so next I want to talk a little bit about the 2D version of this. So what we talked, so everything, is this clear? I wanted to get this across. This is pretty cool application, right? And all you need there is orthonormal matrices. Very, very nice. Oh, by the way, maybe I should also know that these matrices, the Q matrices, I guess that's the point of the compression, that you don't really need to store or even transmit them, right? This matrix, you never have to store it in memory in an array. I mean, you can in your MATLAB implementation, probably will pre-compute it. But the point is that the elements of the matrix are given just by this formula, right? So applying, doing matrix vector products with a matrix, which I have just the formula for its elements, I never have to store the matrix in the memory, right? Instead, I can just have a function that applies the matrix, transposes the matrix, but I never actually have to allocate the memory, right? That becomes important if your n is a million, you don't want to be dealing with a million by million dense matrix, but you don't have to because you just have the formula for all of its elements. I think that's the real strength of the DCP. Okay, I don't want to go into all those details. There are even faster methods how to compute this. Like just applying the matrix vector product, it's not the most efficient way to compute this transformation. There's things like fast Fourier transformation, which can compute it even faster, actually. Again, leveraging the special properties of this formula or the Fourier transformation formula. But I guess I'm getting into too much details. So let's take a look at JPEG. It's essentially the same idea in 2D. So that's for image compression. That's the second part of your project. And the main idea is exactly the same. The only problem we encounter here is that we need to generalize it to 2D signals, right? Because this audio was 1D signal. I was just drawing audio was 1D signal, right? I was just drawing these waves. Well, image is a 2D signal, right? You can represent it in the continuous way, like for example, like this, like an interval. Cartesian product with another interval gives me mapping to some scale values, some intensities, right? That would be like a continuous image on an interval 0, 1 to 0, 1, right? Where this would be my little image, right? And pretty much anything you can represent using the continuous function. Now, discrete image, you know, is formed from pixels, right? So it's exactly the same sampling idea. That I sample with some resolution in both the x-axis and the y-axis. Usually the sampling rate you choose the same in x and y to make life easier. And you know that usual images are like easily like 1,000 by 1,000 or even more, right? So there could be millions of pixels, even more now with like modern cameras, they have pretty crazy resolutions. So how JPEG works, dealing with like the entire image would be a little bit of a pain because it's so long. Maybe let's just do the JPEG. So what JPEG does is it just splits the image into 8x8 blocks, into a smaller blocks, which are easier to deal with. That's just for convenience. You could easily apply it on the entire image, but the things would get much bigger and the computations would be much more complex. And it turns out that it works quite well even on these 8x8 blocks. That's like a reasonable trade-off. Now, what do we need to deal with if we need to somehow convert these images, either the big ones or the small 8x8 blocks? It's still a small image, right? It's a small square. Oh, by the way, if you have ever seen the blocking artifacts in JPEG, if you dial up the JPEG compression, if you like say really aggressive compression, you can start seeing these blocks, right? So are called the blocking artifacts of JPEG. So that's exactly why, because it works. The compression, this orthogonal transformation, the DCT basis idea is applied to 8x8 blocks, right? So certainly on every block you have a different error, and if the error becomes visible, you start seeing the blocks. That's why the blocking. So how do we deal with the fact that we have like an entire 8x8 blocks? Well, what we can do is basically convert. So the 8x8 blocks has 64 values, right? And we can just write them in a vector. That's how we deal with it. There is a cute, that's actually an operation I really love for reasons I will probably explain you later when we know more about linear algebra. So vectorization operation converts a matrix into a column vector. Okay? So the idea is that if I have a matrix M, which would be a matrix M by N, and the matrix has columns M1, M2, up to, what did I say, MN? Oh, I'll give it arrows, so we don't confuse it with this M, which is the number of rows. Then the vectorization of M basically unrolls this entire matrix column by column into one gigantic column vector. So I take the M1 vector, when it ends, I append the M2 vector, and so on until the MN vector, okay? So this gives me an MN by 1 vector. In MATLAB, you can write it like this, M double column. That's the vectorization. Basically, unrolls the entire matrix into a vector. Quite easy, right? Turns out that this has beautiful mathematical properties, which I will explain you later when we know more about traces and things like that. So this is the idea. This is how we deal with it. So this block we can just convert to a column vector. And then we apply essentially the same idea. We need to create a 2D, two-dimensional DCT basis. And how do we do that? We take outer products of the 1D DCT vectors. Did I talk about outer product? I can't remember. Outer product is simple. It's like sort of like the, you can think of it like the bigger brother of inner product. Okay, let me give you a short explanation of the outer product. Okay, so let's take two vectors, AB, which are from Rn. So I said that the inner product is ATB, right? And we discussed this at length before, right? So this is an 1 by n vector, B is n by 1 vector. This gives me a scalar, right? 1 by 1 matrix, aka scalar, right? That's the inner product. Outer product is if I do this, if I do ABT. So that means A is a column vector and B is a row vector. I think I might have discussed it here, not sure. So this would be n by 1 and this would be 1 by n. So notice that everything is cool. Matrix multiplication is defined, right? And this gives me an n by n matrix, certainly, right? N by N matrix. Everybody sees that, I hope. It's just matrix multiplication. It's just like a funny type of matrices, but like everything is cool, right? Everything works. This is N by 1, this is 1 by N. I can certainly multiply them together, right? And this is called the outer product of A and B. Here is a question for you, if you got it. What is the rank of the outer product matrix? So let me explain what exactly, maybe I need to explain it in a little more detail. I guess I'm trying to rush it too much. So if this is my A vector, and this is my B vector, and then what are going to be the elements of the outer product matrix? It's again just like a matrix product again. So the first one will be A1, B1. I hope everybody agrees with that, right? The second one will be A2, B1, and so on. This one will be A1, B2, right? This would be A2, B2, and so on, right? So I take ith row, jth column, I will get AIBJ. There. Okay, So can you notice something special about this matrix? If you look at the columns, for example, what are the columns? So the rank is the dimension. Let's practice our subspaces a little bit. The rank is the dimension of the column span, right? So what is special about the columns of the outer product matrix? I didn't write it all intentionally, because if I wrote it on it, actually it would be too obvious. The thing is that the rank is 1, that's correct, yes. And why is that? It's because what is special about this matrix, outer product matrix, is that each of its columns is just a scaled version, just a scalar multiple of this one, of A, right? This is just A multiplied by B1, this is just A multiplied by B2, and so on, until the last one is again just the A column vector multiplied the last coordinate by Bn, okay? So certainly the column span is just a one-dimensional subspace, right? That means rank 1. As we are there, what is the matrix that has rank 0, as we are already doing this silly? I guess you can think about it, not a silly thing, but a sort of like a recappy prepay type of thing for the midterm. It would have to be a matrix which has all zeros in it, right? That would be. So this is like that's like a dumb trivial example, right? Matrix of all zeros that would have rank 0, but the rank 1, that's a outer product matrix, has like the smallest non-trivial rank, I guess you could put it that way. Anyway, all I needed here is that clear? So all I wanted to say here is that the 2D DCT basis you can get by taking the outer product of the DCT vectors, of the 1D DCT vectors, right? So if we go back to these guys, if we are in JPEG, this n will be just 8. So we'll create this matrix of the 8 DCT vectors, Q1, Q3, Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4, up to Q8. And then I take all of their outer products, okay? Now each of them, for example, Q1, Q1T, actually I have a picture of them. So there will be 64 of them, right? And each of them has 64 elements, right? What I can again do is, those are again A by A matrices, right? So this would be 8 by 8. What I can do is I can unroll them into a column vector, of course, right? And that's gonna be what dimension vector? Come on, tell me quickly. 64 by 1, exactly. And it turns out that if I do this procedure, if I go with the I from 1 to 8, and if I go with my J from 1 to 8, and if I collect all of them, so I will get 64 dimensional vectors, I'll again get an orthonormal basis. This is a beautiful proof of that using vectorization and trace, but we didn't do trace yet, so again, let's wait with that proof. Again, if you want to test it in MATLAB, nothing is easier than that. Computing the outer product in MATLAB, everybody can do, right? So let me show you, if you do this with the DCT, with the 8x8 DCT vectors, let me show you what you get. This is what you get. So here is where it starts. So notice this is all white, and actually makes sense, because what is this guy? This is the Q1, Q1T, right? What was Q1? Q1 was a constant, right? You can imagine it was like constant 1, right? So if I do outer product of vector of all 1s with a vector of all 1s, what I get? Well, matrix of all 1s, right? Doesn't have to be 1, it can be some other constant, but the point is it's all the same, right? What happened here? So this would be like Q1, Q2T, right? So one of them was still a constant, right? So the in Y here, this guy here was a constant, right? So imagine 1's there. And here I had the one wave of the cosine, right? That's why there you can see the gradient there. Okay. Now this guy here, that's the Q2, Q1 transpose. It's the other way around, right? You have the wave in the y-axis and the constant in the x-axis. See that? This Q2, Q2 transpose, that's when I hit the two cosines together and it creates something more interesting. And I can continue the same logic until I get the craziest possible. This is like a checkerboard type of thing. So what JPEG is doing on these 8x8 blocks, it takes every 8x8 block of your photograph, there'll be lots of them, right? And puts like a small piece of your image, and finds coefficients which multiply all of these basis vectors together. All of them are multiplied with some coefficients and add them together and exactly reconstructs your 8x8 piece of your photograph you took with your cell phone or something. And then what you find out for images you take with your cell phone or you take with the web camera or something, what you find out is that here in this top left corner, the magnitudes of the elements will carry most of the energy. Here will be the big, in absolute value, the big coefficients, big. And here will be small, or even close to zero in absolute value. So again, same idea, right? What JPEG actually does, it has like a zigzag pattern thing. So it unrolls the matrix, I think, in like this type of way into a vector, so not using the vectorization operation, right? Because the energy is actually concentrated near the top left corner, right? And then apply some other compression techniques. But the idea being that like these ones below, you can just discard, make them zero, not transmit them. That's how you achieve the compression on images. That's the idea of JPEG. And you can see again here why the energy will be concentrated here, right? Because if you look at some of your images, if you take like an 8x8 block, there probably won't be a lot of variance, right, on most of them. Maybe there will be some edge, in which case that would be an exception. But most parts of the image, they'll probably be like pretty mellow, right? There will not be something crazy going on like here. So these guys will already explain most of your image. Or at least the 8x8 block. Okay? So this is what you're going to play with for your next project. Oh, these Haar wavelets, that's I think an extra credited type of thing. So this DCT basis, that's just one possible choice of a smart orthonormal basis, which can give you very nice data compression. But there are others. You have probably heard of wavelets, right? Have you? That's interesting. It used to be very popular when I was at college. I guess that sort of changed because it used to be very popular and it sort of faded away. But it's still a very interesting thing. It's essentially like a different type of orthogonal basis, different than DCT, but with the same sort of idea. Wavelets are cool. So the difference from DCT is that wavelets are localized. So when I was... Or you can see it even here, right? Here, all the functions basically are touching the entire image, or probably it's better visible here. Oops, here. Yeah. So all these functions are global. On my entire interval, they are there's something going on, right? Wavelets are different. They localize in the spatial domain as well. Oops, sorry. Calibrate. In general, wavelets are scaled and shifted versions of some original pattern. The simplest pattern is the Haar wavelet. So the Haar wavelet, again, starts with just an identity. So I guess if I was going like from, let's go from 0 to 1, let's make it like the continuous version. So this would be my Q1 of the Haar wavelet. The Q2 would look like this. So here is sort of like the, I think sometimes called mother wavelet or something, and it looks like this. So it's like two steps essentially. Like you can imagine this is +1 and -1. I'm just drawing these lines for illustration. So this would be my Q2. do you see this step function? Then what I do next, that's the interesting thing. Next I do a scaled and shifted versions of this function. So I split the interval in half and I scale this step into a smaller step or narrower step. And this is how I get my Q3. And if I want to do Q4, then I do the same thing, just shifted here. So I split my interval in half and I go here and here. This is what I would call my Q4. Okay? Do you see the pattern? What do you think would be Q5 and the other ones? Well, I split my interval in 1/4 and I do the same thing, right? I just scale the mother wavelength. This would be my Q5. And if I wanted to Q6, it becomes like a puzzle, I guess. So 1/4, so this would be the middle part. So here I would go this, bump up, bump down. This would be Q6. And I could have Q7, that would be just the same thing translated, and Q8 would be translated even more, and I could start like next cycle until I run out of resolution. That's essentially the idea of the Haar wavelet. The Haar wavelet is not particularly clever, as you can see, it's not even continuous, right? But it's the most basic idea. And there are some more advanced wavelets, which are sort of cool, they look sort of strange, but this idea still reoccurs there, that they are basically just a shifted and scaled version of the original pattern. You can see this also gives you orthonormal bases. Here it's actually immediately visible in the Haar case. Do you see why it's orthogonal, all these? The Q1 and Q2, you should see that's orthogonal, right? Again, you need to sort of abstract yourself from thinking about vectors as arrows, right? That's not gonna be helpful. What you need to be thinking about is this function or these samples. You can imagine some sampling. Multiply with constant. If you sum it together, here this is plus some constant minus the same constant. That subtracts away. That cancels to zero, right? Same thing with all the other ones, right? If I hit Q2 with Q3, I mean dot product. What do I get? Clearly zero. Do you see that? Same thing with all the other ones. So this way you can construct another orthonormal matrix. And again, you can try using it to transform your signals you captured with like a microphone or a camera. And you can see how well this will perform for compression. Yeah, question?
How about this one? Q3 can't include the one on the right.
What do you mean on the right? Oh, here?
Because like in the cosine one,
it's zero.
Like why can't you combine Q3 and Q4?
I could, yeah, I could. But the point of wavelets really is the spatial localization. That's how they differ from DCT. And by the localization, that means that this whole piece is zero, right? Because ultimately what you are gonna get by the orthogonal matrix is that you will again express your signal as a linear combination of all these guys, right? And the nice thing is that most of them will not be affecting big parts of your image.
So there's not a lot of information in one area, you can just ignore those.
Exactly. So these actually are sort of, if you want to think about it, that they are smarter in the sense they sort of adapt to the area there is something going on, right? Like imagine an image, just like an image which is completely white and only here is something interesting going on, right? Doing DCT on that is sort of stupid, right? Because the waves, they wave all around that image and they are trying to sort of like explain this white area, which is dumb, right? Wavelets in this, if you want to anthropomorphize it like this, are smarter, but they will be able to focus on this region. That's I guess the main idea of wavelets, this spatial localization. You could be studying this for an entire lecture, wavelet transformation. It's sort of cool. Okay, so that concludes the transform coding application. So that was one of the promised applications. So we have linear algebra and applications mix. And we can move on to another topic, which is linear least squares. Starting with projection, yep.
So for colors, you just do it for RGB. So
that's right,
three
yeah.
Times.
Yeah, exactly, you do RGB. Again, if you wanna do like a more advanced compression scheme, you would probably convert it to some more perceptually aligned color system, right? To like a different, what is it, like the Y? There are different color systems, but the point is, yeah, you have three channels, so you just do it three times, that's right. The thing is that you can be exploiting correlations between the individual channels because they are also not completely independent, right? Like if you have something high intensity, probably all the RGB channels will be high intensity. So there is some room for compression there too. And if you are doing video compression, then what this is basically doing is removing the redundancy in the spatial domain, right, in the X, Y dimensions. And if you are doing movie compression, when there is temporal signal, you also want to be removing the redundancy in the temporal domain, right? Like if part of the scene is not, maybe it's very complex, maybe it's a forest or something with high detail, but maybe it's not moving, maybe there is like only guy walking across, right? So certainly you don't want to be transmitting that over and over again. So. Okay, that's a good question. Any more questions? I like the data compression. It's sort of like a dead research topic now because it's pretty much done. Okay, so let's move on to projection, and later we will generalize it to least squares. I guess it's you can see it as another application of orthogonal matrices. Or equivalently, what can we do if we cannot solve a system of linear equation? So by now you know everything, or almost everything, about solving a rectangular system of linear equations. But we don't know what to do if it does not have any solution, right? I mean, what we can do is like output no solution, goodbye. But sometimes that's not the desired behavior. Okay, so let's start with some basics, and the basics is projection. Maybe let me first draw it. So the point of this is to build up to least squares. Okay, so let's start with some simple things. So let's say I have a vector A going from 0, for example, and I have another vector B in some n-dimensional space in general. And what I want to do is I want to do projection of B onto A. So by projection, I mean orthogonal projection. So sort of if A was my ground, right? If like if I rotated it like this and this was the earth and I dropped the vector B perpendicular to the ground, I want to find out where does it land. Okay, so I want to find, specifically I want to find this vector here, which will be the projection of B onto A, right? I think we discussed something like this at the beginning, but it's useful to go through it again because then we will generalize it to matrices. So how can I compute this unknown vector? Well, okay, now you know that this vector A spans a one-dimensional linear subspace, right? And what I'm so all the vectors in the subspace can be written as TA, where T is some scalar. So what I'm looking for, and okay, if this is my TA, then this part will be B minus TA, right? If I subtract the two vectors, if I do B minus TA. And if I want orthogonal projection, then it means that I want B minus TA to be orthogonal to TA, or just to A, the T doesn't really matter there. So that means that I want my B minus TA transpose A to be 0, right? Everybody follows? Good. So let me simplify this a little bit. So this gives me this, right? So So that means that T is A transpose A dot product with B, A transpose A. Okay, that's quite easy. So this is how I can compute the orthogonal projection. Okay, I think we did it before in the case where A was unit, and then A was unit, this just happened to be one, and this just reduced to the dot product. Easy stuff, I hope. So that's what's also drawn here. We can similarly compute the perpendicular component. So if my projection, if I denote the projection of B as B parallel, that's what I just this is what I just derived. That's the ATB ATA times A. That's the parallel component of B, the component of B in the direction of A. And the orthogonal component, that's what I get if I subtract from B the B parallel component, right? So that's what's written here. So the orthogonal component of B is B minus the parallel component. I denote it like this. This is a sign for parallel. This is a sign for orthogonal. And I just computed this is the ATB divided by ATA times A. And here is an interesting way how I can express it in matrix form. So basically what I have here is ATB on the top. This is just a scalar, right? The ATA is also just a scalar. So it's a scalar divided by a scalar, right? So this is scalar multiplication of a vector. So what I have here is ATB times A. Now, AT would be a row vector, right? B would be a column vector, and A is also a column vector. So I cannot really go ahead and write ATBA because this does not make sense, right? I can be only multiplying matrices or vectors with the right dimensions, right? I cannot be multiplying two column vectors together. I can do a row vector and column vector. In that case, it's inner product. Or I can do a column vector and row vector. In that case, it's the outer product. But I just cannot do two column vectors. That's not defined, right? These dimensions have to match. You know that. Now, but what I can do is I can do this. Because ATB is just a scalar, I can as well write it here. I can as well post-multiply with it, right? And then what happened is here I have a column. Here I have a row. Here I have a column. Here I actually can apply associativity. Here I can use AATB. Because this is defined, this is, again, our friend outer product, okay, AAT. And that's exactly what happened here. This is how I got this expression. So here the B I can also write as identity B, right? So this is how the identity matrix appear there. And this ATBA I just rewrote like this, where the AAT is an N by N square matrix, okay? So it's important to get the types right. Let me write the types there. So I'm not confused. This is N by N matrices. This is just a scalar, one by one, if you will. And the B, of course, is an n-dimensional vector. So this whole thing you can just write as a matrix. Already this thing is a matrix. I can call it P as a projection matrix. So AAT divided by ATA. The type, it's an N by N matrix. It's a matrix that performs the projection onto the vector A, or onto the subspace defined by vector A. Okay? So if I give you an arbitrary vector B, the way you can compute this projection is just by doing PB, right? It's a linear transformation, so I can represent it by a matrix. That's exactly the matrix that does that. Okay? Now here is an interesting... Everybody follow that? Here is an interesting thing about the projection matrices is that if you square it, if you do P times P, what do you get? Let's see. So this ATA is just a scalar. It's just some sort of normalizing coefficient. Now I will have it there twice, right? And I will have AAT, right? But I can put the brackets also like this, right? And because this is just a scalar, it means this now commutes, right? Because scalar times vector is commutative. So I can put the scalar here. ETA. Oh, yeah, sorry, I didn't really need the norm here because this is just a scalar. That's why I say it's important to think always about the types. So this is AAT. So this is just 1 over ATA AAT. But this is just the original matrix P. So this is a special type of matrix, the projection matrix. If I square it, I get the same matrix back, interestingly enough. Lots of matrices don't really do that. Why is that true here? Because this just says, think about the geometrical, it just says that if I apply the projection again, it doesn't do anything anymore, right? The projection takes my vector B, projects it onto A. If I project it again, has to do the same thing, right? So project it twice is the same as project it three times or a million times. It just gives me the same thing as projected once, okay? Okay. So here is a variation. There are two of them, right? So this AAT divided by ATA, that's the projection matrix, and this one is the complement. It gives me, so one gives me the B parallel, the one gives me the B orthogonal. So this is the other one. Now you can also subtract this twice. So the idea is that I just project. So how I get the B orthogonal, I just take B and subtract the B parallel, right? Now if I subtract it twice, what do I get? Let's think about it for a second. It's getting late, so I'm getting sloppy, but it's okay. So the B orthogonal I got by subtracting B parallel from B. If I subtract it again, what do I get? I get something that goes here, right? This was my origin. So, and what this means, this is basically a reflection about this line, right? I sort of reflected this vector B. That's what happens here. So if I just subtract it twice, this is not very important, just like an interesting sort of side note as we are already discussing this. This is like important in graphics when you are doing like shading with reflection models. It's also very important in numerics. It's called the Householder transformation. It's the basis of many numerical algorithms. And the point where I'm trying to get to is, okay, what I'm after here. What I'm after is to be able to do something intelligent. If we have a system of linear equations and it does not have any solution, what can we do about it? Okay. As far as mathematicians, so this is an example of a system that does not have any solution. So as far as mathematicians are concerned, no solution and a discussion, right? But if you are engineers, that's usually not the case, right? Because the matrix and your right-hand side, that can be measurements, right? And there can be some measurement noise. Even if there is not measurement noise, there will be rounding errors, right? Because on the computer, everything is just approximate, right? So maybe actually you were looking for something that was supposed to have a solution, but you just are not seeing it due to measurement errors, right? So you would want to find the next best thing to a solution, right? And that's what the least square solution is. So if you cannot find a solution exactly, what you can, so the solution, if I wrote it as AX equals B, so if no X exists, that AX would be exactly B, what you can say, well, okay, so how about I just minimize the error, AX minus B, okay? Give me an X such that this error is minimal, right? For example, if the problem was that this was just corrupted by some noise, then you would expect that this would be sort of close to the true solution, which you just don't see due to the noise, right? If you sort of expect to see some x, AX is going to be close to B, but maybe it's not exactly zero, maybe it's like 0.00001, then this is what you can do, that you can find the least squares solution. It still makes sense even if AX is very far from B. It still does have an, it still has applications. I'm just trying to sort of motivate it. And this leads to least squares, and I think this will, this is what we will be discussing the next time, because it takes a little while to explain this properly. But here you know what we are going for, so we will discuss that on Monday. All right, any questions? All right, let's call it a lecture then.